Well, we are going to look at John chapter 8 this morning. And this passage that we're looking at actually picks up a little bit of what we looked at a couple of weeks ago in John chapter 7. And just so it makes a complete sentence, we'll start with John 7:53. They went each to his own house. Now, there are many things about Jesus that we don't know for sure. Pretty much history and tradition has it that he didn't own a house. But many of the people that worked with him opened their houses to him. And we know he didn't always stay outside. But this is a case where verse 1 picks up, they went each to their own house, but Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. That doesn't mean he didn't have a place to stay, but it means that prayer and being alone with God were bedrock to him, that was more important to him than sleeping. I wish I could be more like that. I just seem to need sleep. I'm not very good at giving up sleep and praying through the night. I do pray when I wake up, but Jesus was in a habit, and this Mount of Olives was a place that he often went alone to pray. Very seldom actually had his disciples go with him. And they were a bit more like me. They tended to fall asleep when they're trying to pray at night. But he went there to the Mount of Olives. And remember, the day preceding that, he had been debating with the scribes and Pharisees, the leadership of the Jewish nation there in the temple courts. And it had quite a long day. And early in the morning, after spending the night, it looks like, in the Mount of Olives praying, early in the morning, he came again to the temple. And all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. Now, the temple courts were open to people of all faiths. They could come there. It was a place for the nations to come and approach God. And we've seen other places in Scripture, not here, but they actually sold things there. You could change your money to be temple money there. So it wasn't a quiet, private place. It was a public place. And there were people in and out doing all kinds of things. And that's where they were, where they were teaching. And if you think about it, the message that Jesus had, he already knew was not going across very well with the Jewish leadership. He already knew that he was in trouble, so to speak. Remember, he didn't go publicly to this feast with his family. He let them go ahead on their family caravan, and he came in quietly later. And we believe much of that. In fact, God's word says it was because his time had not yet come. It wasn't time for him to be crucified. That would happen in about 6 months from the time that we are here. But he went publicly to this place and was teaching people. And much like he, during the Olivet Discourse, during the Sermon on the Mount, much like those times, he didn't stand up and lord his message over people and say, do it my way. Instead, he tended to be a teacher who sat down and look people in the eye and taught them kindly. But verse 3 tells us that he's in this public place, and the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery and placed her in the midst. And they said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now, in the law of Moses, it commands us to stone such a woman. So what do you say?" Now, they were setting him up to get in trouble either way. This was like a no-win thing. They had courts within the Jewish leadership to deal with things like this. So it's not like Jesus was the only person who could decide. They had courts that they weren't using. They could not legally carry out their own law. Their law in Deuteronomy 22 says if people are caught in adultery, that both the man and the woman should be brought and stoned to death. That was the law of Moses that they're referring to. But verse 6 reminds us that they did this on purpose. It was a setup. This they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. So the charge would be blasphemy. If he said, no, 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 you can't stone this woman, he would be breaking the law of Moses. If he said, yes, go ahead, stone her, they would be breaking the Roman law and going against, and he couldn't legally do that. They couldn't legally stone this woman without going through their own court system that Rome did honor and let them kind of deal with their own messy stuff and their own law. But it was always ultimately the Romans who would decide that someone could actually be executed, just as we'll see in 6 months. Really, it was the Romans who decided that Jesus was going to be crucified. And so Jesus is here in a place set up on purpose in a public place with people that he had just been teaching and explaining things to, explaining who he was, that his father had sent him, all those important things to them. These people who were against his ministry have decided this is how we'll get him. We'll bring this woman. Now, people have speculated that why is it that they only brought the woman and not the man? You cannot commit adultery on your own. And why is it that they only brought the woman? And we don't know. Scripture does not say. But it isn't as though no one really believes about this story that the woman was falsely accused. We really believe that consensus is that she really was caught in the very act of adultery. And it's important that we not twist the story as most people do and say Jesus is showing here that adultery is not really that big of a deal. That's not what the story is about. And he is not saying that the law is not that big of a deal. Adultery is something that divides families, that hurts and cuts and destroys relationships, almost like nothing else as far as a marriage relationship. In fact, Jesus used it, and God the Father inspired writers in the Old Testament to use it as a model of Israel betraying their God with idols. It's all through Scripture to show just how despicable God felt adultery was. And that's important for us to realize that sin is sin, yes. That Jesus did not come to say he was easy on sin, don't worry about it, let's just let everybody sin as much as they want. Jesus loves them anyway. That was not his message. And in this case, Jesus bent down and wrote on the ground, wrote with his finger on the ground. So the temple courts were not paved. They weren't tiled floors. They were dirt. And he wrote in the dirt with his finger. Again, I can't tell you the number of sermons I've heard where people speculate as to what he was writing. I think that you could probably speculate, but why would you? When God doesn't reveal that to you, that means, again, you're missing the point of the story. So to go off and speculate about what he might have been writing is missing the whole point. But verse 7 says, and as they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. Now think about that for a moment. That's the point of the story. All have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. All of us here, all in that group. The point of the story is that when you focus on throwing stones, when you focus on how good you are, how much better you are than someone else, well, I at least don't do that, and I can't believe they do that, and pick out your brother or sister or somebody who's not a believer, pick out their sin and focus on that, you're missing the point of the gospel. And many things come up into our hearts, well up into our hearts, and do make us angry, indignant, self-righteous. We it's an honest feeling that we have, and I'm not saying that you should deny your honest feelings, but that you should take them to the Lord and say, okay, God, I feel this way when I'm confronted with this sin. It bugs me. I can't believe people do that. And that's what these people, they were setting Jesus up to make him fail no matter what, but they were really disgusted about adultery. They really felt that marriage was really important and it needed to be honored. Now, they did have some double standards. They specifically were disgusted by women who broke their marriage vows. They're often a little soft on men who did it, but they did feel that women should always be loyal to their husbands. No matter what their husbands did, that they should always be good and not commit adultery. And they felt that so strongly that they weren't thinking about what it must be like to be this woman and bring her publicly to humiliate her without her co-sinner involved at all. That was not even entering into their thinking about this. They were using her as though she were an object, not even a person, just something to get what they wanted to do to Jesus. They just used her, manipulated her, took her sad, sinful situation and tried to put it to their own benefit to get what they wanted. Now, you might think you would never do that, but as I have meditated on this passage, I realize that we do that. That we take issues that involve sin, and we throw them up in the air and make a big deal about them to try to get our way, to try to make the world be like we want it to be. And that is not our job. It's God's job to judge sin. It's God's job, and he does it well, to convict hearts. And I'm not saying, I've already said this once, but again, I'm not saying that if people in the church who know better are participating in sin without repentance, I'm not saying that we just turn a blind eye to that and say, well, I can't judge anyone, whatever. We have an obligation to go to our brother and sister and say, do you realize what you're doing is against God's law? Let me pray with you. Show me why it is you're struggling with this. We don't just ignore it and turn a blind eye to it and do nothing. But it's not our role to say, I know you deserve to go to hell. You are bad. Looking at you disgusts me. This is terrible. That's not our role. And I do believe that God is disgusted by sin, but not because of the sin per se, but because of what sin does to harm us, his children that he loves. And he saw from the very beginning, the first choice towards sin has done nothing to people but to degrade and dehumanize and take them away from God. So it's important to God that it is not in our realm of things that we are to do things like they did to this woman. And I think that whenever we are just aroused with what we feel like is righteous indignation, God is saying, bring that to me and let me show you what I want to do with that energy you're feeling. I think there is something God wants us to do with it, but it's not stone the woman. It's not humiliate the person. It's not degrading to whoever is the object of our anger. It's showing us that this isn't fair, that there are things that are happening that are not fair, and God cares about that. God cared about this woman being humiliated in this way. He cared that she was caught up in the sin of adultery. It didn't cause him to stop loving her. God has not stopped loving your enemies either.
That's right.
The people that bug you the most are dearly loved by God. And for us to say, bad person, you just disgust me. I cannot believe anyone would do that. That's what these people were thinking about this woman. The energy that we feel, the passion that's there, can be taken by the Holy Spirit and used for good. Or it can be used in a human way, like throwing stones, used to make the situation certainly no better and maybe worse. But they, verse 7, continued to ask him. And so he stood up and said to them, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. Now we use that line that Jesus said as an excuse to be soft on sin. That's not what Jesus was pointing out. He was pointing out, who of you is qualified to know what's going on in this woman's heart? Who of you is qualified to stand as God before her? And remember, Jesus is the judge. He's the one who will one day judge this woman if she didn't repent, and me and you. So he's standing there right there, the righteous judge. He's the only one there without sin who could have taken a big rock and hurled it at her. He would have been within his realm of his role. But instead, once more, he bent down and wrote on the ground. And if you think about that, I've already told you it doesn't really matter what he wrote. It probably was irritating to the scribes and Pharisees. Like, he's just pulling our leg. Why won't he just, you know, go on with this? But his sentence, any one of you who was without sin, go ahead and cast the first stone. He's saying God's law is true. It does say to stone people caught in adultery. But who of you is really able to make that judgment? And when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Now, I'm going to make just a little bit of a leap here. Remember, the group that brought the woman, scribes and Pharisees, they were the big wigs of the Jewish religion. They knew the law. They knew what they were doing. They had authority where they were. But remember, Jesus had been talking to people who were just interested in him and his ministry and hearing what he had to say. Do you think they all left when the group showed up with the woman? I don't really think they did. It doesn't mention them here, but I think they're, wow, I wonder what he'll say to this. I think they were there. They also, in the way that the law happened, if they felt that they wanted to, could have picked up a rock and thrown it at the woman. They all left, one by one, starting with the older people. I think older people do have an ability to kind of reflect back on their life and realize, I stand amazed in your presence, Lord, that you would even look at a sinner like me. I think the older that we get, the more we realize, especially if we've made Jesus Lord of our life, what a mess we've made of our life. Just how much better we should have been able to do with all that we were offered, all we were given. And so the older people would, in this culture for sure, have the most authority, were leaving. And then slowly, even the young whippersnappers who really thought they knew everything, they all left. So we have only the woman standing before him. I can't imagine what was going on in the heart of that woman, but because of what Jesus says to her, I believe she was sorry. I believe she was feeling, oh God, help me. I've really messed up. I'm sorry. I don't believe she was standing up defiantly looking Jesus in the eye. I think she was on the ground kneeling or on her knees or in some kind of low position. And she was not looking up arrogantly. I just believe that she was sorry. Now, many people are not sorry for their sins. Many people are caught in something that they're shaking their fist at God and saying, you can't tell me what to do. And I'm not pretending, again, that if the woman was doing that, I don't believe Jesus' answer would have been the same. But remember, Jesus was able to discern what was in the heart of man. He wasn't fooled by people who would pretend to be agreeing with him but really weren't. He knew that people often were flatterers, they often lied, that they're often doing things just to get their own way. But he stood up and said to her, woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? And it was almost like he said this to help her to look up and look around and realize, where are they? They're gone. And she answered him, no one, Lord. And Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more. Now, that's an important part of this message that Jesus is getting through, not just to the woman, not just to us, But to everyone who comes to him, it's important for us to turn from our sin and not do it anymore. That's right. Some sins have a way, they have just this way of grabbing you back. Sins of addiction, sins of pleasure, they have a way of, you make a commitment that you are no longer going to sin, but next thing you know, you're tempted again. You know, it's just there. And do you think God doesn't know that? Do you think he doesn't get it? For you, what's the one that's hardest, or the three or whatever? He absolutely knows that. And the real important thing to God is that your heart is saying, God, help me with this. I want to sin no more. People who trick themselves and others into believing they really are perfect without sin are living in the middle of the self-righteousness sin, which is probably harder to catch, harder to repent from, harder to even understand that you are self-righteous than adultery, you know. And so we don't want to get ourselves into this idea of sinless perfection, like we're so sanctified, we're just perfect, we never have to worry about sinning again. And sometimes you may find yourself praying for that. If you struggle with something that's embarrassing, that shows that you cannot hide from other people, that they recognize you are the town drunk, you know, and you keep doing that, and you keep upsetting your family, and you can't hold a job, that's a very out there humiliating sin. It's hard to be that person. And the level of shame that comes upon the sinner sometimes is the hardest part. So when we heap more shame and say, well, I'm having nothing to do with that, they aren't trying very hard because I'm not an alcoholic and I can do it, so they should be able to do it. Whatever your pet thing is that really bugs you may actually be sort of the flip side of what you actually do. Your way of sinning may have a more pretty face to it, may not show to people, may be hidden. It's the whole idea of families and alcoholism and addiction, how it eats away at people and causes them to do things like obsessional things and perfectionism, where you're really hurting people everywhere you go. You're tossing those stones and you're just making strife in your family and hurting people all the time. But you look pretty okay. You're able to do it in a way that doesn't really reflect too badly on you. But people don't want to be around you. They don't want to hear your criticism of them. They don't want you to come to their party. They don't want you to come to their house. They wish you'd go away and leave them alone, actually, because you are so hurtful. And it's funny how that is, that some people out there with their public sin are actually hurting themselves very badly, maybe even hurting their immediate family, their children, their wife, their husband, but don't really hurt the rest of you very much. And if they do something like drive drunk or get in an accident, we have ways of clamping them in prison forever and making them feel terrible and really getting our vengeance back on them. Whereas these people who have been often exposed to or experienced those things themselves, their sins hide underneath. They creep into churches. They creep into neighborhoods. They destroy people's trust in one another and in God, and really are probably just as or more harmful. But she says to him, no one, Lord. There was no one that could meet Jesus' test. And his test kind of flipped on its head. The people bringing her were focusing on adultery and law breaking. Jesus was flipping that and saying, look at yourselves. Look at your own heart. Take a moment and really examine that, because we all tolerate our own sin. Even when the Holy Spirit convicts us of it, we tend to justify it. We tend to think, well, I'm trying, and look at all these other people, God. Can't you just pick on them for a while and leave me alone? Paul says in Romans chapter 2, verse 1, therefore, you have no excuse, O man. He's talking to Jewish people who are disgusted by Gentiles, who will not keep the law like they do, who don't believe in all the rules like they do. We have two groups of Christians. One group of Christians came out of Judaism. One group of Christians came out of pagan religions. And the Jewish Christians think they're better than the pagan Christians because they're such good law keepers. Their sin is so deeply hidden and covered up that no one could ever hardly find it if they tried. It's like that needle in a haystack thing. But Paul says, you have no excuse. Every one of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself. And this is all through Scripture. We can find lots of other examples of Jesus teaching this because you, the judge, practice the very same things. Now, we don't know. These scribes and Pharisees may have been adulterers. People have speculated that maybe one of them was actually the person caught in adultery. We don't know any of that. But we do know they believed that this woman was a solid case of sin and that they could catch Jesus because there would be no argument for her. Every single one of us stands in that place. And whether we have ever committed adultery, whether we have ever done sin to hurt others, and I'm sure we have, I certainly have, but let's just say we haven't. We've only hurt ourselves. We haven't just purposely disobeyed God's laws. The Bible says that every single one of us have fallen short. Every single one of us. And we know that verse so well, we just flip it right off. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But do you really live it? Do you really live it like the person that you are the most mad at, the most disgusted with, the most you just cannot believe they would ever do that? Are you really able to say that, but for the grace of God, that's me, that's my brother, that's my sister? Some of the people might speak a different language than you. Some of the people might have different goals in life than you. Some of the people might not want to go to church ever and say no thank you when you invite them. Some people have been so turned off by church that I believe God is moving us to a different model of evangelism, a different model of how the gospel is presented, because churches have a bad rap. They are considered to be places full of hypocrites, full of people who say one thing and do another, full of people who are so good at sinning, just like these scribes and Pharisees, that they're actually sinning directly against God. Jesus, who they were trying to betray in their worship of God, they were betraying his own son. And ultimately, 6 months later, they would be part of the group that ensured that he would be crucified. We know Jesus said, no one takes my life, I lay it down. But the people who were accusing him, looking for things to bring against him, thought they were doing it. If you'd have had to say, who did this? They would have been proud to raise their hands. I found out this about him, and I reported it the day that he made that man carry his mat on the Sabbath, and I reported it the day that he actually allowed that woman in adultery to go away. They were keeping score and proud of it. I think it's so important that we see the truth of this story. It's not a made-up story. It's something that John related. It's so important that early on, copies of the scripture lost it. So the very earliest manuscripts that we have do not have that recorded. Later ones do. So people say, people made that up to try to say adultery was okay, to try to make women look like it's okay. They have all kinds of ideas. What I really believe, this this story, when you meditate on it and read it and bring it into your heart, just shines with the love of Jesus. You can't argue with it. But I really believe, as it was in the original manuscripts, and I can't prove this, and that hateful people who were trying to make God out to be someone else took it out, but that there were manuscripts later that said, here's that story, we're missing that from our Bibles. And when we look back, it looks as though it was added late. But I can't prove that to you. Nobody who translates Bibles thinks this story shouldn't be there. Right. Everyone says, this story clearly reflects the heart of God. It's a worthy teaching. We believe this really happened. But when there is a truth that is so powerful, so able to change your life if you will just meditate on it and ask God about it, that would be the one that the devil would pick to make disappear. So I don't have any feeling that we shouldn't look at this as scripture, but I think it's powerful to know how hard people have worked to make it go away, to make it disappear. And because of that, I think the safest thing for you and for me to do is bring it to the Holy Spirit and say, what about this, God? I don't really like it that they can't find this story in the earliest manuscripts that we happen to have. We don't have the original autographs. We have no idea who was really there or not there. But the earliest ones that we have don't show this story. Now, the other thing that happens sometimes is that we'll do that, and then someone will make another discovery of an earlier one, and oops, there it is. You know, it's happened in other parts of Scripture, but so far, not for John chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. Today, as we close, I think that we have an opportunity to make a fresh start. Even though we're already here believers, maybe not everybody who's listening is a believer, Jesus, just like the woman taken in adultery, wants to forgive your sin. All you have to do, you don't have to fix it first. All you have to do is say, I recognize, God, that I'm living in a way that does not please you. Help me. I want you to be Lord of my life and help fix me. Sometimes God works on the sin that you're not really all that bugged about, because that's the one that really hurts his heart. So sometimes the thing that you're praying about, God, fix it, take it away, I don't want to be tempted by that anymore, is low on his list. And it takes a while. It takes a lesson kind of forgiveness where you just walk through it and trust God. But what I know for sure is when you say, I surrender all, I want you to be Lord of my life, Jesus, come into my life, save me, he does. And that it makes all the difference in the world, that people cannot be good on their own. They can hide. They can make their sin look pretty. They can fix it up in a way that nobody notices, but they can't be good. I can't be good. You can't be good. Only the Holy Spirit in your life can help you do that. And we drive people away by focusing first on their sin rather than on their need for a Savior. And we in the church have such fancy rules, almost as fancy as the Jewish church had, that it holds people back. It keeps them beyond the door. It says to them, I could never come there. I don't know how to be like you. And we have no right to do that if we continue to. And the Lord cherries, I think, that our churches will be empty. And if they're not empty of people, they will certainly be empty of the Holy Spirit. And there's no point in going to a church that has a form of godliness but denies the power of the Holy Spirit to change lives. That is pointless. And if you're wondering, do I have your power in my life, Lord? The test is, do you care about people who are caught in their sin? Do you care about that more than you care about your comfort, more than you care about being embarrassed, more than you care about being understood. And if you don't, you're living a life that is a form of godliness. It looks good on the outside, but denies the power. Because God's power will make you love the sinner.
That's right.
Amen. Love the sinner, not throw stones. As we close today, I just ask you to look into your heart. Ask the Holy Spirit to look into your heart and come just as you are. Jesus did not ask the woman to clean up her act. He did not give her a list of rules. He said, go and sin no more.